was the night before Christmas when all through the house not a creature was stirring, not even a mouse. The stockings were hung by the chimney with care in hopes that St. Nicholas soon would be there. The children were nestled all snug in their beds while visions of sugar plums danced in their heads. And Mama in her kerchief and I in my cap had just settled down for a long winter's nap. When out on the lawn there arose such a clatter, I sprang from my bed to see what was the matter. Away to the window I flew like a flash, tore open the shutters and threw up the sash. When what to my wondering eyes should appear but a miniature sleigh and 8 tiny reindeer. With a little old driver so lively and quick, I knew in a moment it must be St. Nick. More rapid than eagles his coursers they came. He whistled and shouted and called them by name. Now Dasher, now Dancer, and now Prancer and Vixen, on Comet, on Cupid, on Donner and Blitzen, to the top of the porch, to the top of the wall, now dash away, dash away, dash away all. So up to the housetop the coursers they flew, with a sleigh full of toys, and St. Nicholas too. As I drew in my head and was turning around, down the chimney St. Nicholas came with a bound. A bundle of toys he had flung on his back, and he looked like a peddler just opening his pack. His eyes, how they twinkled, his dimples, how merry. His cheeks were like roses, his nose like a cherry. His droll little mouth was drawn up like a bow, and the beard of his chin was as white as the snow. The stump of a pipe he held tight in his teeth, and the smoke it encircled his head like a wreath. He had a broad face and a little round belly that shook when he laughed like a bowl full of jelly. A wink of his eye and a twist of his head soon gave me to know I had nothing to dread. He spoke not a word, but went straight to his work and filled all of the stockings, then turned with a jerk. And laying his finger aside of his nose and giving a nod, up the chimney he rose. He sprang to his team gave a whistle, and away they all flew like a down of a thistle. But I heard him exclaim as he drove out of sight, "Merry Christmas to all, and to all a good night."
Hello and welcome to The Collegium, our monthly magazine program in three parts: cinema, state of affairs, and our arts calendar. In addition to staying cool, remember you are participating in what else but The Collegium.
Paris has long been a haven for artists from all over the world, going back to the 19th century. But for one artist, an African-American who dared to make the leap It changed his life. His name was Henry Osawa Tanner.
Tanner is the first African-American to achieve international status as a painter, as an artist. He had numerous challenges and obstacles during the course of his life and his career, but he kept going.
The big problem was race. Tanner was raised in Philadelphia, the eldest child of the family. His mother was born to a slave named Elizabeth, who managed to get her children to the North. His father was a bishop in the African Methodist Episcopal Church, socially and politically active, a deeply religious man.
Whenever I talk about Tanner, I encourage people to look at the banjo lesson, because I think there you see represented before you the nature of the relationship between the father and the son.
With his father's blessing, Henry became the first African American to be accepted by the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts. But not everyone was happy about his being in their academy.
One incident was particularly traumatic for him when a group of students who were somewhat jealous of his ability and his aloofness, Tanner was quite shy and withdrawn, and also the rules of segregation, they took him out of the school and crucified him, according to them, on his easel. I think there were a number of incidents like this. He would dwell on them to the point where he would get depressed and he couldn't paint.
After his studies, Tanner struggled to make a living at painting. But galleries in America would not accept paintings by black artists at that time, no matter how talented they were.
So he decided he'd leave and go someplace where he could pursue his artistic interests without having to fight racism.
Paris opened Tanner to the world.
He could go anywhere he wanted to go. He wasn't restricted. And for Tanner, that just gave him a great feeling of liberation, not to be restricted by Jim Crow laws or by segregation.
Tanner was 32 years old when he arrived. He enrolled in the Académie Julienne. He said, "I had little money, but I never suffered anything on account of my color. No bars were ever put in my way." It wasn't long before he was invited to join the newly formed American Art Club. And he was free to exhibit his paintings at the Paris Salon.
I often quote James Baldwin, who said that when Americans come to Paris, they discover the terms by which they want to define themselves. And that was truly the case with Tanner.
His breakthrough came in 1896, when his luminous painting, Daniel in the Lion's Den, won an award at the Salon de Paris. The following year, the French government bought his Resurrection of Lazarus for the Luxembourg Museum. It made him internationally famous.
He changed from a provincial to an internationalist, and that's a big step. And it's a very big step for an African American, because we have two provincials. We have the provincialism of being American, and then we have the provincialism of being an African American. And so to break out of this takes a lot of courage.
Tanner married Jesse Olsen, an opera singer from California of Scandinavian descent. They had a son named Jesse. The Tanners lived happily in France with no racial slurs or incidents, unimaginable for mixed couples in the United States at that time.
When he achieved success here in Paris, word got back to Philadelphia that there was this extraordinarily talented African-American painter who'd found freedom and success in Paris. So Tanner, over the next 20 years, became the dean of American painters.
Almost every African-American artist who visited Paris in the 1920s made a pilgrimage to see Tanner.
Well, I think for many African-American artists who followed him, Henry Osawa Tanner was the person who one seeks inspiration from, who the person who one aspires to be like, as someone who pulls on all of their talents to do the extraordinary in terms of painting.
By the time these artists started coming to Paris in the 1920s, Tanner had achieved international acclaim because not only had he been given the French government's highest award, the Legion of Honor, in 1923, but also he received the status of full academician at the National Academy of Design in 1927.
Of all the honors his work received, none would have pleased him more than the acquisition of this painting by the White House, the first by an African-American artist in its art collection.
Hillary Rodham Clinton said it best when she was summing up Tanner's career. She said that talent always has the ability to transcend prejudice. That was certainly the case with Tanner. Thank you.
The title of this evening's program was chosen by Dr. Claude Panton Jr. as a consequence of this poem, the title of this poem being one of his favorite poems by Mavis Meaki, my daughter. Looking back is the title of the program, therefore. This being one of the earliest of Mavis's works, and it is a tragedy that I have to come here and preside over this matter, you could say, really, with regard to her not being able to attend. So we've gathered here in praise, in celebration of her life and achievements, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters. The poem and lyrics and philosophical ideas that are now that have been included in the body of works in print and available in the more reputable bookstores around the world in these you can find this poem, a couple of stanzas of which I will read to you at the moment. Looking back over yesterday is like a museum of old photographs. I stand and stare in amazement, feeling incomplete. I murmur these words again and again. The pen is mightier than the sword, but mightiest of all is the source. The source, the source, the source. When traditions alone fail to tell you what, when, and how to think. Looking back over yesterday is like a museum of old photographs. The songs of my past are now the music of the future. Everybody dancing, 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 and so on and so forth. As a parent, I've always encouraged Mavis to follow her own vision, as well as the things that she wrote, many of which she read to me at the hour of their conception and throughout the course of their development to the point where she was satisfied with them. As a result, at which point they would be locked away in various places. Were also the things she had forged a deep and abiding attachment with, like this poem by Sterling A. Brown, which Dr. Claude Panton Jr. III will now read for us with Dr. Farrakhan Khalik on brass, soprano sax, I believe, correct? Thank you. Gentlemen, please. And by the way, it is by way of a drunk in a pub telling a story, or a legendary tale. You will hear it. Many of you here, I'm sure, being student of this sort of literature, know this poem very well. Gentlemen.
I want to thank you kindly, Reverend, for having me here. The Ballad of Joe Meek. You can't never tell how far a frog can jump. When you just see him planted on his great big old broad rump. Nor what a monkey's thinking by the working of his jaws. You just can't figure, and I knows because had me a buddy, soft as pie. Joe Meek they called him, and they didn't lie. The good books say, turn the other cheek. But there weren't no turning for my boy, Joe Meek. He turned up all parts and begged you to spank, pulled down his bridges and supplied the plank. Brother Joe, I love that boy. I just love him, love him, love him. Yes, I do. Well, anyway. The world curve that didn't turn was a rattlesnake to Joe. Wasn't scary, just meek, sir. Was made up so. It was late in August, what they call dog days. Made even beetle hounds get bulldog ways. Would make a pet bunny chase a bad bloodhound. Make a newborn baby slap his grandpa down. Ooh, now you know that baby's bad. The air, it was muggy and heavy with heat. The people, they all sizzled, like frying meat. The ice house was heaven. The pavements was hell. Even Joe didn't feel so agreeable. So strolling down Claiborne in the wrong end of town, Joe saw two policemen knock a poor gal down. Well, he didn't know her at all, never saw her before. But that didn't make no difference to my boy Joe. Walks up to the cops and very polite, and asked them if they thought they had done just right. One cracked him with his billy above the left eye and thugged him with his pistol and let him lie. Like Richard say, you go down there looking for justice and that's what you find, just us. Well, you know, that's just a little aside twixt you and me. Anyway, when he woke up and knew what the cops had done, went to a hock shop and got himself a gun. Felt more out of sorts than ever before. So he went on a rampage, my old boy Joe. Shot his way into the station house, rushed right in. Wasn't nothing but space where the cops had been. They called the reserves and they called the National Guard. Joe was in a cell overlooking the yard. The machine gun sputtered, didn't faze Joe at all. But every time he fired, boom, 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 a cop would fall. Hallelujah, Jesus. Somebody just help me. The tear gas made him laugh when they let it fly. Laughing gas made him hang his head and cry. You know, that kind of crying. He threw the hand grenades back with an outshot droop. And every time he threw, there was one less cop. The chief of police said, what kind of man is this? And held up a shirt for an armistice. So now you know you gotta be suspicious right now. Cause like Desmond Tutu said, they brought the Bible, and when they looked up, they had given up the land, and all they had was the Bible. I don't know, one can think about that. But anyway, stop gunning, black boy, and we'll let you go. I thank you very kindly, said my old boy Joe. We promise you safety if you'll leave us be. And Joe said, that's agreeable, sir, by me. The sun had gone down. The air, it was cool. Joe stepped out on the pavement, a fighting fool. Had walked from the jail about half a square when a cop behind a post let him have it fair. What else can you expect? Put a bullet in his left side and one in his thigh. But Joe didn't lose his shooting eye. Drew a cool bead on the cop's broad head. I returned your favor, and the cop fell dead. The next to last words he was heard to speak was just what you would look for from my boy, Joe Meek. Spoke real polite to the folks standing by. Would you please do me one kindness before I die? Won't be here much longer to bother you so. Could you bring me a drink of water before I go? The very last words he was heard to say showed a different Joe talking in a different way. If my bullets weren't gone and my strength all spent, I'd send the chief something with a compliment. And we'd race to hell and I'd best him there like I would be done here if he'd have played fair. So you can't never tell how fast a dog can run when you see him sleeping in the noonday sun. So the moral is, walk softly, but whatever you do, brother, keep you a big stick and the powder dry. Thank you, Reverend. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you, Dr. Claude. Oh, thank you. Thank you both. Thank you both, really. I think one of the things that Mavis found so fascinating with literatures of this nature was the issue of the constant problem with police brutality. There's a very clear image in it of police brutality and the reaction that a lot of this creates in return as a consequence of people who would otherwise be peaceful and have noble and humane intentions to follow human beings. I think I need to say that very much the sense of my being in this rather prestigious company is directly as a result of having Mavis as a daughter, a talented person, etc. Therefore, I think I need to say who these gentlemen are. This gentleman here, Dr. Claude Panton Jr. III, is a lecturer in film studies and history at University of North London. And as Dr. Farrakhan Khalikh is also is in University of the Caribbean, professor there. That's right, a professor of compositions and literature. Interesting combination. And over here, Dr. Joel Francis Kierke. Basically, I need to say that the reason they've come together, they've joined me here, is as a result of what has happened over the last 7 months, when we gathered then on my daughter's birthday, her 23rd birthday. They have the result of the publicity and everything that has gone on. We know a lot about that and the marketing business that is sort of machinery that slipped into motion, things over which I have no control and wouldn't necessarily wish to control, because I think most of what is out in the market, i.e. the songs and the people involved with them, are involved for the right reasons. For my part, really the struggle will be not to let the the impending promise of superstardom, i.e. celebrity, gets in the way of my daughter's the memories and heritage on a personal level, and I think also on a public level. And whatever comes out of it, i.e. money and things of that nature, will be spent wisely, and that is a promise indeed. I need, therefore, to turn to Dr. Kierke to find out from you, as a result of you also being a professor at associate professor at Berklee College of Music, and with so much time you spend in London, and to the extent that my daughter came to you and asked for private personal tuition as in drumming, in percussion instruments and things like that, and you agreed. And I have heard from my sources that you are a very busy man and you are very fussy who you teach, et cetera. And in general, you don't do that other than in university. But you decided to take her on. Would you like to tell me why, what was essential about her talents and what fascinated you or interested you about your meeting with her? Briefly, as you wish to, and we go into a demonstration after this.
Yeah, well, aside from being a very beautiful woman,
thank you.
Very talented, very gifted person. And you don't meet people like that every day, so that was the main reason.
Well, I agree with you. I guess everyone would say I would, but it is true. She was exceptional. That's why we are here, and it is a sad affair that we are here. But I'm delighted that you've all come to join me. It will make the burden immeasurably lighter. I'd like, basically, as a spontaneous thing, that we have several hours to get through this order of proceeding and to really celebrate her memories and achievements, etc. And one of the tragedies here, really, is that you were all supposed to be a teacher to her, but it never happened. You all accepted to take her on in your field of expertise, and it never happened because of what has happened, the outcome. Well, but when she played for you, when she met you, much of which she told me about, was that you played her something and she played it back to you, and she was never one to boast, but she told me that she took the idea much further, and I don't know very much about all of this. So if you then would like to demonstrate, if you can remember, or some impression of what you played her, and when she and she played back to you, and you then, etc. You both, and then you can join in also.
Well, she had obviously been practicing, because she knew quite a few rhythms before she came to me. So I was pretty amazed. She could play basically jazz rhythms and things like that, for swing, for instance. Like that down, or she was even modern rhythms, where she was doing modern hip hop rhythms there.
Yeah.
You played that already, which was very surprising.
It was an idea about jazz and blues, which the thing that happened.
Right.
You can remind me, or let us all hear some of that, basically, as she impressed you that day.
Okay, we'll do a little
I'd love you
rhythm
too.
That she sort of was working on.
Okay. It's a sad occasion, but it's still a celebration. Thank you very much indeed. This is splendid. I saw to the public, as it were, the audience, the imaginary audience, whatever. I will read some of that, and because I think it is important. It is fine writing. With one particular horse called Nugget, he embraced. The animal digs its sweaty brow, and they stand in the dark for an hour like a necking couple. And of all nonsensical things, I keep thinking about the horse, not the boy, the horse, and what it may be trying to do. I keep seeing that huge head kissing him with its chained mouth, nudging through the metal some desire absolutely relevant to filling its belly or propagating its own kind. What desire could that be? Not to remain a horse any longer? Is it possible that at certain moments we cannot imagine a horse can add its sufferings together, the non-stop jerks and jabs of its daily life, and turn them into grief? What use is grief to a horse? The thing is, I am lost. You see, I think I will stop there. It is fascinating. I might just go on too much. We have lots of time. We will take a short break in a short while. Before that, I will ask very much for, I think a blues would be quite in order, that we play out on a blues, or at least we play a blues, another blues, if you would be happy to do that. It is also one of my favorite things, and we shared a lot, and we had a lot in common, shared many fascinating songs and albums and blues things, blues and jazz things, interest in thereof. Get together again, I will tell you a very funny story. It's anecdotal, and it's about the composer Chopin. But that's for later. For this moment and this while, I thank you very much, and I look forward to being back out here on the tragic circumstances to talk with you again. I'm feeling better now than I did the last time we met, 7 months ago.
Yeah, I was thinking about this the other day and thinking about how I used to be able to run around and do whatever I want to do. Can't do it anymore. Looks like things are moving on. Things are passing me by. Wonder what is going to happen to me. Takes it all away, yeah. And where does it all go?
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Was it here before I came? And will it be here when I am gone? Then, who needs it anyway? I am losing all my time.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
I'm breathing all my time away. Use it, use it, use it while you may. Use it, use it, use it while you may. Cause it's going gone, going gone, going gone.
Cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Cause it's going. It's going anyway. It's going gone, going, going, going anyway. Time's up, baby cakes. And I'm
cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Meine Zeit läuft mir davon. Alles fällt so schwer. Freunde? Ich habe nicht mehr sehr viele Freunde. Was bleibt mir noch? Was kann ich noch weitergeben, bevor es zu Ende geht? Meine Zeit läuft mir davon. Zeit. Wo kommt sie her? Wer braucht sie sowieso? Was nimmt sie alles mit? Wohin geht die ganze Zeit?
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
War sie hier, bevor ich kam? Wird sie da sein, wenn ich geh? Dann, wer braucht sie sowieso? Ich verliere meine Zeit.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Atme meine ganze Zeit davon. Nutze sie, wenn du kannst. Weil sie vergeht. Tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack, tick, tack. Sie vergeht, vergangen.
Time's up and baby cakes and you're out. Time's up and baby cakes and you're out.
Time's up and baby cakes and I am out.
My name is Bärbel. I'm from Germany, and I want to give you a small impression how it feels to come from a foreign country or from Europe to the United States. I'm married to a black American. He's in the army, and I met him in Germany. After living in Germany for a while, he had the order to come back to the States. So I followed him, and now here I am. I am in the States. I left my family, I left my friends, and it was very strange at the first time. I have to speak in a different language, and it is very, at the beginning, it is very hard. When I compare Germany with the States, there are so many different things over here. Everything is big, the fashion is different. I was very scared about all the violence I can see on the TV, and even between the people in the normal life. We lived in Germany for about 1.5 years, and it is different to be married or to have a friendship with a black man in Germany, or compares to the States. I mean, when I came here, I felt suddenly not as a German married to a black man no more. It was like the color matters all of a sudden. Well, he's black, I'm white, and people look at me like a white person all of a sudden. I'm German, I mean, I'm German, and I never had experience with discrimination, or like in the States, you put the people in categories, like they're Asian American, they're black Americans, they're white Americans, they're Hispanic Americans, and now I try to figure out who I am. To live in the army on a base, it's also a different thing, because all the people, they are used to foreigners. They're used to people from all over the world. And I think it's easier to live on a base, on an army base, than to live in a civilian life. And of course, I try to do something here in the States, even if it is difficult for me.
Ernestine Anderson, A Lovely Way to Spend an Evening. Ich würde gerne im Rahmen von Jazzradio dem Berliner Fountainhead Tanztheater und seinem Direktor Professor Donald Muldrow Griffith gratulieren. Denn die haben eine ganz besondere Auszeichnung erhalten, und zwar vom Bündnis für Demokratie und Toleranz für den Einsatz von Professor Griffith und seinen Kollegen zur Förderung der hervorragenden Beziehung der Gemeinschaft durch ihr TV-Programm The Collegium. Das Programm wird dreimal die Woche vom Community Channel Alex Berlin ausgestrahlt und darüber hinaus in anderen Städten Deutschlands und in den USA. Gestern wurde die Auszeichnung im Roten Rathaus verliehen. Und ich darf auch nebenbei noch erwähnen, dass Professor Donald Muldrow Griffith ein ziemlich talentierter Jazzsänger ist. Und welch schöneren Weg gibt es, zu Toleranz und Verständnis aufzurufen, als durch die Kunst, durch Musik und durch den Jazz. Also Gratulation. Und hier und jetzt geht's natürlich auch weiter mit Jazz. Soul Talk sind hier mit Loving You.
On a clear day, rise and look around you, and you'll see who you are. On a clear day, how it will astound you that the glow of shines every star, you'll feel a part of.
Italian shore. You can hear from far and near a world you've never heard before. And on that clear day,
sort of reminiscing, if you will, about a woman that I fell in love with a long time ago. Well, this was a very special woman. You know, I thought I was a pretty cool dude, smooth as it could be. But when I met this woman, well, I found out that I wasn't quite as cool as I thought I was. She was beautiful, intelligent, talented. But she was powerful. There was something very strong about this woman. But over a period of time, she decided to show me her vulnerable side, and we came together. And it was wonderful. But of course, there's a sad side to this story, too. And the sad side basically was my fault. I'll tell you about it. I was saying, I don't know, I made some mistakes and I caused us to come apart. I did everything I could think of to win that woman back.